This program aims to find solutions to your medical queries. It seeks answers to common health problems that have been hounding you. We will help you out in finding answers to your medical concerns. Good evening, everyone. I'm Angel Jacob, and this is MedTalk, your weekly on-air health consultation here on 9TV. Pancreatic cancer has been in the spotlight in recent years, with many famous names known to be afflicted with the disease. The list includes Apple co-founder Steve Jobs, Italian operatic tenor Luciano Pavarotti, actor Patrick Swayze, Nobel Prize winner Ralph Steinman, and local action star Rudy Fernandez.
Pancreatic cancer is not that common. However, the problem here is it generally is recognized at a later stage. And when we talk of cancer, it means that the tumor has a malignant behavior. In pancreatic cancer, there are several cells that are quite important. And the reason here is because this behavior of cells will influence the prognosis or the chances of survival in patients.
Pancreatic cancer is a silent yet aggressive disease, usually spreading quickly before any symptoms are noticed by both the patient and the doctor.
The problem with pancreatic cancer is that they generally are discovered late. And the reason there is they do not have a specific symptom. Meaning to say, patient will feel discomfort, but this discomfort can be interpreted as discomfort coming from some other things. But nonetheless, pancreatic cancer patients generally present with pain. They can present with jaundice, meaning to say they turn yellow, okay? And sometimes they present with weight loss.
Nevertheless, since pancreatic cancer has poor survival rates, early diagnosis and medical attention are integral, alongside the proper understanding of your risk factors. What causes pancreatic cancer? What are the available treatment options? Find out the answers tonight on MedTalk. Joining us tonight is Dr. Cherry Marquez, Section Head for Medical Oncology at the Asian Hospital and Medical Center. She's also a member of the Philippine Society for Medical Oncology. Also joining us tonight is Dr. Michelle Simbol Cloa, a gastroenterologist at the Manila Doctors Hospital. She's also a member of the Board of Directors at the Philippine Society of Digestive Endoscopy. You may join in the discussion by calling our hotline at 548-4678. Good evening, doctors. Welcome to the show.
Good evening, Angel.
Let's get to learn more about our pancreas. Tonight it's all about pancreatic cancer, but let's understand the function first of our pancreas and where exactly is our pancreas located in our abdomen. Let's start with you, Dr. Mitch.
The pancreas is an organ located behind the stomach. It is pear-shaped. It's about 6 inches long, and its function is to produce digestive juices to help you digest your fats, your proteins, and your carbohydrates. And it's also essential in producing your hormones that regulate sugar, which is your insulin as well as your glucagon. Mm-hmm.
We also know this among us Filipinos, we call this lapay, no?
Lapay.
Lapay.
Okay. Yan. So lapay is...
Dito siya.
So ito yon.
Yeah, here.
It's so, behind the stomach and beside the liver.
Okay.
Near the spine, at the back.
All right. Not a lot of people are familiar with the function of our pancreas, aside from it producing insulin.
Insulin and digestive juices,
and
which
digestive
is important.
Okay, which is important in digestion.
Digestion, basically, yes.
Okay. And there are certain medical conditions that are associated with our pancreas. What are these?
The most common, of course, is pancreatitis, usually associated with alcoholic beverage drinkers. as well as patients who have gallstone diseases. Mm-hmm. So also associated with, as you said a while ago, off-screen, bangungot. You know?
Yes. When we hear of pancreatitis, I really want to bring this up. It's bangungot. It's a mas popular siya na, yeah. na known as bangungot. What exactly is pancreatitis? Are there different stages? And why is it associated with bangungot?
Well, pancreatitis, when you say that, it's actually inflammation or pamamaga ng lapay. Mm-hmm. And actually, there can be several causes, but some causes are also unknown. And it can either be acute or chronic pancreatitis. So acute pancreatitis, doctora, usually, yeah. no, after an alcoholic binge or even after heavy intake of fatty foods, no, this can trigger acute pancreatitis. Well, there are patients who can also be having chronic or long-standing inflammation of the pancreas. And sometimes this is associated with patients with diabetes,
okay.
Patients with gallstone.
Mm-hmm. If I may just add,
yes,
not
please.
All bangungot are caused by pancreas, no? But there are also
let's not blame the pancreas.
Let's not blame the pancreas for the bangungot, okay.
But if it's going to be the pancreas, the most common disease entity associated with it is the hemorrhagic type or the severe type of pancreatitis. So when that happens, the digestive enzymes, instead of being secreted out of the organ, eats the pancreas itself, producing the severe autodigestion of the pancreas and severe inflammation. So, so severe that patients do not wake up anymore.
Oh my! So that is the one that's fatal.
Oh yeah, but I'm not saying that all bangungot are caused by pancreatitis.
Mm-hmm. You've mentioned acute and chronic pancreatitis. Acute pancreatitis, is this all of a sudden?
Yeah, usually after alcoholic binge. Patients who do not, especially for occasional alcoholic beverage drinkers, and then all of a sudden, they drink alcohol and then binge on alcohol. And oftentimes, the history is when they go to the emergency room, they have very severe pain centered over here.
Okay, so sa lapay, sikmura?
Sa may bandang sikmura po.
Oh, okay. So, walang sign or symptom yan that you have something wrong with your pancreas until there's an excessive amount of alcohol in your body. Tama
yes,
ba?
Yes. So, but once it is treated, it can be actually resolved. No, so it's not long standing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but
so it can be medically managed with antibiotics, yes. With fasting. But there are some that would be also severe, as Dr. said.
Okay, so pain in the abdominal area.
Sometimes it radiates onto the back. No, very severe pain.
Okay, so this is different from appendicitis.
Very different.
It radiates also. Eh?
Especially
so
the location.
Uh-huh. Okay.
The location per se is different because pancreatitis is centered here, whereas appendicitis is more on the lower side.
Okay. So where does the pain radiate from, just to orient all our viewers?
So usually patients with pancreatitis, the pain is felt from here, boring into the back. So patients would say masakit, tumatagus po hanggang likod. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's very typical of pancreatitis.
Okay, so masakit, tumatagus sa likod, that's that could be your signs and symptoms. How about the treatment? How do we alleviate the pain of someone who's suffering from pancreatitis?
So patients with pancreatitis are generally admitted because they need to be placed on nothing by mouth. And oftentimes, they improve with hydration of fluids, as well as sometimes we give antibiotics to address any infection that might be going on inside the pancreas.
Mm-hmm.
Some are advised to have ICU admission even for better monitoring and management.
Okay, so pancreatitis is just one of the many medical conditions associated with the pancreas.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Another medical condition associated with the pancreas, our topic for tonight, is pancreatic cancer. Please tell us about pancreatic cancer and what happens to the pancreas when these cancer cells attack, Dr. Cherry.
Usually, the cancer cells would, most of them, if you would look at our VTR here,
yes.
So the cancer cells would start in one place, and the hallmark of cancer would be its uncontrollable growth. So it will spread initially covering the area of the pancreas only, mm-hmm. but then it can spread further out. It can go to the nearby or adjacent organs, and it can affect adjacent or even distant lymph nodes and eventually distant organs.
Okay.
So when that happens, what does the patient feel? Unfortunately, the symptoms or yung nararamdaman ng pasyente, they are usually manifested when the patient already has advanced stage of the disease.
Okay. So advanced stage of the disease, is there any other way to diagnose pancreatic cancer? Because if it's here in the abdomen, yeah. and when you press hard on your abdomen, you can't feel a node. I mean, for you in the medical field, yeah, no? yeah. experts in this area, when you press it, you don't feel a node. So that's why yeah. it's not easily diagnosed. And when it's diagnosed,
by the yes, time the doctor is able to feel it or the patient is able to feel it, then it has become large enough, and usually it has involved already the surrounding organs. Mm-hmm. And by that time, it's no longer curable most of the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And because it mimics, because it's centered here, it mimics peptic ulcer, all those acid-related disorders.
Okay.
Because sometimes the initial symptoms can be very vague.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes the patient just complains, oh, I get easily full.
Yes.
No, I just yes. eat a little and then I'm full already. Or sometimes I just a little loss of appetite. Very vague initially.
Mm-hmm. Or when you eat and you eat and then you feel like throwing up after a while?
Well, some patients have that, yeah.
But usually by that time, it's already big. The tumor is quite big already, mm-hmm. such that it already affects like the stomach.
So you've mentioned affects, Noah. Are there a lot of people affected by pancreatic cancer?
Worldwide, it's quite, it's not in the top 10. If you combine the developing and developed countries, it's not really in the top 10 causes of death from cancer, but it's getting there. For developing countries, maybe it's ranked between 12th or up to 16th leading cause of death. But for the developed countries, it's right inside, around ranking number 9, mm-hmm. no? And for the U.S., it would also cause maybe the deaths of both sexes. It would rank up to the fourth leading cause of death from cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So it's quite, it's not that common, but unfortunately it figures prominently in the mortality part because a lot of the cases would be detected very late,
mm-hmm.
and only so much treatment can be done by that time.
Mm-hmm. So that's why we're doing this show also,
yes.
just to inform yeah. everyone, to educate everyone that if you feel something in this area, mm-hmm. that this, yung hindi mo naman usually nararamdaman.
Then, Angel, if I may add,
yes, please.
In male population, it comes after the lung, the prostate, the colon, and then the pancreas. But in mm-hmm. women, it comes after the lung,
and the breast,
the colon, and then the pancreas.
Oh, okay.
So,
in the ranking, kumbaga, yeah. nasa top 5 siya.
Yeah. yeah.
No?
In the Philippines, I think in 2008, they estimated around 600 to 700 cases,
mm-hmm.
no, for the males, and then around 600 cases for the females.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, we need to understand there's probably some underreporting of yes, the cases.
Yeah. Yes. And these that you've mentioned, the gender, are some risk factors which we will talk about also later on.
Yes.
How is pancreatic cancer diagnosed before we cut to a break? How is it diagnosed?
Well, of course, we do the usual history physical examination, and they usually present with a triad of weight loss, jaundice, and pain.
Okay.
No? Although in the early stage, they don't present with pain, only yellowing as well as weight loss.
So jaundice is a classical presentation, would you
yeah,
say?
Oftentimes, especially if the cancer involves the part of the pancreas, which is called the head, because it embraces the bile ducts that drains the juices from your liver.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever that mass or tumor enlarges inside the head of the pancreas, this, you know, somehow impinges on that duct, and the pigments accumulate inside your body. So that's why you present with jaundice.
Ah, okay. So it doesn't necessarily mean, it can also be hepatitis. Yeah, it can turn yellow. It can mimic hepatitis
as well.
Several
causes for jaundice.
Yes. Yeah, okay. Because it's, you know, patients would present with jaundice, and then patients would be worked up for hepatitis, or they would be worked up for possible stone in the common bile duct, mm-hmm. or biliary stones. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, before arriving at a diagnosis.
So you have to go through that stage, so to speak, to eliminate all the other possible medical conditions.
That's the symptomatology, and then by physical examination, you would see patients yellow. And then sometimes you will feel fullness over this area, and then sometimes you will feel that the gallbladder is enlarged. It's what we call Carbosier's gallbladder. Mm-hmm. So somehow pathognomonic of pancreatic cancer.
So once you feel all these symptoms, you should...
We go for further diagnostic testing.
Okay, who should we, or who should the patient seek medical assistance from? What type of doctor?
Usually when they complain of like abdominal pain, yellowing of the skin, of course, they usually go to the gastroenterologist, no, internal medicine or general family physicians
or surgeons.
And then once there is a diagnosis or a suspicion of a pancreatic tumor, then other specialties will also be involved. Mm-hmm. They may be referred to an endocrinologist. They may be referred to a medical oncologist, radiation oncologist.
Okay. Thank you, doctors. We'll cut to a break. We'll talk more about pancreatic cancer when MedTalk returns.
Another famous personality who battled pancreatic cancer was American professor Randy Pausch. Pausch gained worldwide attention after his video, The Last Lecture, Really Achieving Your Childhood Dreams, became a blockbuster hit on YouTube, paving the way to many other media guestings, including a New York Times bestseller.
We're back here on MedTalk, still talking about pancreatic cancer. Doctors, let's talk more about the symptoms of pancreatic cancer. Dr.
So aside from abdominal pain, the jaundice, patients would usually come in with unexplained weight loss or unintentional weight loss.
Why does that happen?
It can either be as a direct result of the cancer secreting some substances that will induce the anorexia or the loss in appetite, or sometimes it's because mechanically it will impinge on the stomach, thereby affecting the appetite, no? Or what you mentioned earlier, the nausea and vomiting. Mm-hmm. Some patients, because of the jaundice, they have itchiness of the skin, no, that cannot be alleviated by the usual over-the-counter drugs, and some patients, they will present with a new onset diabetes.
Okay.
At that, parang elderly na sila, dun pa lang sila nagka-diabetes. So you can also try to investigate if there's another cause for that.
Mm-hmm. So diabetes may also be a complication of
a complication or a risk factor.
Okay. About
also anemia, ano?
Anemia also. So there are several symptoms that may lead to pancreatic cancer, that may lead to the diagnosis of pancreatic cancer. Do all of these symptoms have to be present, or do we just count one or two or three that are present and then that can be diagnosed as well?
Usually it's a combination of symptoms that would prompt the patient to seek consult
Okay.
with the doctor.
All right. And after consultation, what is the next step for the patient? How do you go about with a medical history, mentioning risk factors as well when the patient comes to see you?
Well, risk factors, we ask for alcoholic intake, history of alcoholic intake, history of previous pancreatitis, especially the chronic type, chronic recurrent type of pancreatitis, because it's a risk factor. We also ask if patient has a history of recent onset diabetes, especially in a person who does not have any family history of at all of diabetes, and then all of a sudden, siya lang mag-isang lumitaw. So we usually ask that. Then we also ask for history of cancers in general, even colorectal cancers, because there are syndromes or that is also high risk for developing pancreatic cancer. We also ask for family history of polyps, multiple polyps, or polyposis syndrome.
Because cystic fibrosis can also develop in the abdominal area near the pancreas, is that?
No. These are the polyposis syndromes that
numerous polyps in the colon.
In the colon.
So also puts a patient at risk for pancreatic cancer. So these are elicited during the interview.
Mm-hmm. So we mentioned earlier being male is also a risk.
Males have about 20% or 30% higher risk of getting the pancreatic cancer than females.
Okay. How about an age? Is there a particular number where one is more prone to getting pancreatic cancer?
Well, pancreatic cancer is really a disease more of the elderly, but usually you can begin suspecting it in patients who are 45 years old and above.
Mm-hmm. Off-cam, we were saying, because it's really the wear and tear of our body. I mean, if we don't take good care of it, if we abuse and misuse our bodies, then it will really take a toll. Yeah.
Because with aging, there's accumulation of all the mutations. Yes. And sometimes if the patient has a genetic tendency, these mutations, instead of being repaired or being removed by the body as it should normally, well, then the risk for cancer increases. Mm-hmm.
Family history, does it play a big role as well in pancreatic cancer?
Yeah. As I mentioned, we should ask for anybody, especially in the first degree relative who had been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, because most likely it puts you at risk also of developing pancreatic cancer. In fact, there was a study subjecting people without pancreatic cancer yet, but who have relatives with pancreatic cancer. They subjected them to screening modalities, and they were able to detect early cancers in all of these, in most of these patients.
Mm-hmm. And detecting cancer or pancreatic cancer in these patients, there is already, a lead already into addressing that type of cancer if it does happen to the individual because of family history. Yes, Dr. Cherry.
As for the risk factors, what's also proven was history of cigarette smoking.
Yeah.
Okay.
Even obesity, and that's also linked with the diabetes, as a risk factor. Mm-hmm. And as for the genetic predisposition or tendency, maybe around 10% of pancreatic cancer cases can be due to a familial or hereditary cause. Mm-hmm. So 90% is sporadic. So hindi nila alam, wala silang kamag-anak na may ganon, but they had it. Mm-hmm. But if you had the first degree relative, your chances of increasing the risk would be about 4 to 5 times higher than one with no relative or first degree relative with the CA. Mm-hmm.
Let me just go back to the smoking per se. Is the number one risk factor that is really associated with pancreatic cancer. Mm-hmm. In fact, they have studied patients who have withdrawn from smoking, and their risk returns to the normal or the average after 15 years of the cigarette.
Wow.
Yeah.
So that should give enough information to all our viewers.
Because more than alcoholic drinking, to stay away it's more of the smoking, yes.
So more than the alcohol, it's a smoking.
The smoking is a bigger risk
for pancreatic cancer.
After talking about the risk factors for pancreatic cancer, let's go to the different types of pancreatic cancer. start with that?
Well, the most common still is the adenocarcinoma of the pancreas, which composed of the more than 90% of all the diagnoses for pancreatic cancer. The rest are the neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas, you have your cystic tumors of the pancreas, and the rest.
So let's define each one briefly, the adenocarcinoma first.
Well, the adenocarcinoma involves the ducts, mainly of the pancreas. And
what are these ducts supposed to do in our pancreas?
Well, they should be able to drain the digestive juices and at the same time activate the metabolic enzymes so that you will be able to digest your foodstuffs. No?
Okay.
So somehow something happens inside. That's why eventually there's a tumor growth developing in the duct, involving the ductules, the acinar cells, etc.
So after the adenocarcinoma, what is the other type again, Doc Cherry?
The more uncommon types, it can be squamous, meaning it involves the epithelial lining of the pancreas, or it can be adenosquamous, meaning a combination of the adeno and the squamous. And about maybe less than 4% of the cancers will be the neuroendocrine tumors, meaning the tumors that will involve the endocrine glands or the ones that would secrete hormones such as insulin and glucagon, which we need for our body's normal metabolism. There are also, as Dr. mentioned earlier, there are also tumors that are benign, meaning they are not cancerous. So some of them present as cysts.
Okay, so not all tumors are cancerous.
Yes.
Upon diagnosis na and then further treatment will...
Because per se, when you see tumor, there's a growth.
Okay.
But it remains to be proven if it's cancerous or not.
So we speak of a tumor, the different stages of pancreatic cancer. Let's talk about that. The tumor grows in different stages. Is there a certain size to when you diagnose or when you detect the tumor?
Usually when it's stage one, so it's stage one to four. So stage 1A, the tumor is still confined within the pancreas and it's about 2 centimeters or less in measurement. And then stage 1B, it grows a little bigger than that, but still confined within the pancreas. And then stage 2A, it has gone beyond the pancreas. And stage 2B, it has already involved the lymph nodes. So it has gone beyond the borders of the pancreas, but has not yet invaded the big blood vessels around it.
Okay.
And then stage 3, that would already cover the tumor involving the big blood vessels, no? The arteries and the veins. And finally, in stage 4, it has already spread to other organs, so beyond the pancreas. So sometimes it can spread to the liver, to the lung, to the bone, to the brain, everywhere actually.
It's metastasized already.
Yes, so that's stage 4.
Stage 1 and 1A, this is treatable. Treatable with what type of medication, surgery? What is done when
usually
one is diagnosed
they classify
stage
that
one?
As resectable, meaning there is a big possibility of being able to remove the entire tumor just by surgery, and that is the one that would give it the best chance for cure. So that is the treatment of choice, is surgery early on. So they call it resectable, and usually there the survival rate, of course, goes a little higher when when surgery is done.
Okay. Stage 2, is it the same surgery that must be done, just take out the tumor for stage 2 pancreatic cancer?
Usually, in either stage 2 or 3, it can either be borderline resectable, meaning the tumor is big, yes, and it has spread just a little bit off. So sometimes they will try to shrink the tumor first before doing the surgery, either by doing chemotherapy or giving medications through the veins, or plus minus with radiation therapy. And then when the tumor has shrunk enough, then they schedule the surgery. Or sometimes in stage 2, they do the surgery first, and afterwards they do the chemo. And radiation.
So chemo and radiation for stage 2. 3 and 4, do you still recommend chemo and radiation? Or
actually, in certain cases for the 3 and the 4, surgery will no longer be done unless it is for palliation or relief of certain symptoms. So the mainstays of treatment at that time would usually be either combination of chemotherapy and radiation or chemo alone, especially if the patient is already quite weak and already in advanced stage of the disease.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, the best chance of the patient is to be a candidate for surgery. Mm-hmm. Because the
stage 3 and 4.
Yeah, because, stage 1.
Stage 1.
Because the chemotherapy, the radiation therapy, we're no longer looking going for cure already, unlike in surgery.
Okay, so surgery off the bat.
So that's why we need to pick them up early and determine if they are operable or non-operable.
Okay. Doc Mitch, Doc Cherry will talk more about pancreatic cancer when MedTalk returns. We're back here on MedTalk, still talking about pancreatic cancer. You may join in the discussion by calling our hotline at 548-4678. Doctors, let's talk now about the myths of pancreatic cancer. Myth number one, pancreatic cancer is always deadly.
In general, pancreatic cancer has a poor prognosis. Without treatment, you know, the patient can die in 4 to 6 months' time. But with the advent of very good chemotherapeutic agents, we are able to prolong the patient's life up to about more than 2 years. Wow. There's even a study up to 36 months, 2 years up to 36 months.
So that kind of treatment will make the patient comfortable. Not necessary. Is it a cure? Can it be a cure?
As long as the patient is treated at the earliest stage, no, 1 and 2, this would give him the most favorable outlook.
Okay, so pag 3 and 4, then a more aggressive type of treatment is needed.
Yes.
Okay. Myth number two, doctors. Pancreatic cancer only affects older people. You mentioned the age earlier.
Yeah, because if you mention, if you say 45 years old, that's not yet old, right?
No, definitely not.
But definitely, if you're going to the literature, anybody who is 45 years old and above is at risk already for pancreatic cancer, although we see them oftentimes in the 60s, 70th decade.
Mm-hmm. But siguro when you're in your 40s, no, and you know you have a family history, you might as well have it. Yeah. Is it included in the checkup, the executive checkup?
Not really. Unlike cancers like breast cancer, colon cancer, or cervical cancer, where you actually have recommendations for screening for almost everyone at average risk. Here, screening, if at all, is recommended for individuals who are considered high risk for it. So those with first degree relatives with pancreatic cancer. So for them, they should be more cautious and have themselves checked. They have technologies now like an endoscopic ultrasound or MRIs, mm-hmm. and in consultation with your specialist, no, if you consider yourself high risk or you learn that you have a family member afflicted with this, then it's good to have yourself checked.
Sometimes laboratories or in part of the executive checkup, patients are requested for CA19-9. But this is a tumor marker that is not really specific for pancreas. But sometimes if it is elevated somehow, it confirms the diagnosis of pancreatic cancer. Mm-hmm. But let me just, there's a caveat only that not all elevations of this tumor marker means already pancreatic cancer, because it can also become elevated in states wherein there is infection of the biliary system, mm-hmm. if there's obstruction, if there is yellowing of the eyes or jaundice. Mm-hmm.
So there's a blood test.
For liver cancer, we usually check for alpha fetoprotein, but for pancreatic cancer, there's a low predictive value really for the use of this tumor marker, CA19.
The tumor marker is usually more useful if the patient is already known to have pancreatic cancer and you want to assess mm-hmm. the response to treatment, or is there any chance of it recurring. Okay. So the doctors will usually monitor that in the next few years.
Okay. Dr. Smith, number three, you should avoid physical contact with anyone during radiation therapy.
Okay. The most common types of radiation therapy for cancer patient, the most common would be the external beam radiation therapy.
Okay.
And usually with that, there is no precaution. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make the patient radioactive, and you don't need to stay away from that patient.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, there's also administration of radioactive iodine. These are mostly for thyroid cancer patients. And for these types of patients, this is radioactive, so they really need to have precautions, no? The patient should stay away from people for a few days until the radiation dose actually levels go down.
Mm-hmm.
And they are advised to stay away from pregnant women, babies, children, for several weeks after, I think.
Because mm-hmm. sometimes, you know, when you go for therapy, radiation therapy, or you come visit your doctor, you bring a family member with you.
Yes.
So I think that's the concern out there.
Okay.
All right. Myth number four, surgery makes pancreatic cancer more likely to spread.
Well, the answer to that, surgery is the cure for the pancreatic cancer.
Yeah, tumor, no?
So don't be afraid to undergo surgery if you have been advised to undergo surgery, because your physicians are going for cure.
Mm-hmm. So it won't spread. If your physician says you have to undergo surgery at the soonest possible time, no?
Yeah.
Can the cancer recur even after surgery, long after surgery?
Yes, it can.
Mm-hmm. That's why there are regimens that they give for recurrent metastatic or recurrent pancreatic cancer.
Okay.
So sometimes even if the patient was detected at an early stage of the cancer, so the surgery was done, so she would still need additional therapy, adjuvant therapy like chemo or chemo radiation, mm-hmm. to further decrease the risk for recurrence. And that's also why the patient needs to continue having a follow-up with the doctor, even for several years after.
Mm-hmm. When you're diagnosed, before we go to the next myth, when you're diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, when you're diagnosed with this type of cancer, your quality of life changes, no?
Yes.
Are you still able to go to work? Are you still able to do certain activities that you used to do prior to the diagnosis?
Well, maybe it's more up to say to the patient that you just have to enjoy enjoy life. Then go slow in your activities already.
Mm-hmm. Stress is also number one on the list of aggravating certain
because
types
oftentimes
of diseases.
Because of their symptoms, they become malnourished, they eat poorly, and they have anemia. Sometimes they have distressing itchiness also, as well as the jaundice, as well as the debilitating pain for some patients.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we can offer palliation for these types of patients who are not candidate for surgery, especially for those who have yelling of the eyes. We put in stent in the biliary system to drain the bile that comes out, that should be coming out into the small intestine. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes if there is obstruction or impingement of the small intestine in your stomach because of the tumor, we can also do stenting or put in something there to open up the lumen so that the patient will be able to eat better. Mm-hmm. And then for palliation also, for nutritional build-up, we do not forget also nutrition.
Yes.
Nutritional advice for all of these patients. Mm-hmm. Sometimes pancreatic cancer is also a risk factor for developing thrombosis or develop clots, so we can also give anticoagulants.
Okay. Dr. Smith, number six. In pancreatic cancer, the size of the tumor is the most important factor in predicting the outcome for the patient.
The size of the tumor is important, but it has to be taken in combination with the other factors in the stage of the tumor.
Okay.
So aside from the size of the tumor, is there involvement of the lymph nodes? And is there involvement of the other organs?
Yes,
so in short, the higher the stage, then the poorer the outlook, but the lower the stage, then the better the outcome.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in knowing all of these things, or in the information that you've given us, it's really important to monitor our body, no, and its function. If, yeah, like I've said, if it's not functioning the way it's supposed to, then we better seek the help of our doctors.
Or maybe even undergo an annual checkup.
There you go. Oh, the annual checkup is really important, no? Lalo na if you're in a highly stressed environment, mm-hmm, or you're exposed to chemicals.
And if you have risk factors, left and right.
There you go, yes. Not to forget, the risk factors that you are exposed to. Or even if you're not exposed to it, genetics sometimes does play a big role in developing not only pancreatic cancer, but different types of cancers. Doctors, this time we have a Facebook question.
Okay.
What are the chances that the treatment will be successful? Is the treatment likely to cure the cancer, or will it primarily prolong my survival?
So again, here the primary consideration is the stage of the cancer, the extent of the disease in the patient's body. Mm-hmm. So if it is limited stage, and surgery is still possible option, then go for it. And the chances for cure is much higher. Definitely, the survival is better. No? But of course, as the stage progresses, some of the treatments, if it's as advanced stage, like stage 4, the treatments, whether it's surgical, no, like putting in a stent or giving chemotherapy and radiation, this can still prolong the life of the patient and hopefully improve the quality of life. Of course, if the patient is by that time very weak, we will also offer only the appropriate therapies. No, so sometimes, like in chemotherapy, if the patient is stage 4, has stage 4 cancer, but is relatively healthy, usually we give combination of drugs, maybe 2 or 3 or even 4 types of chemotherapy drugs. But if the patient has poor performance status, meaning quite weak, very symptomatic, and you just really want to palliate the pain, relieve the pain, then we can either give one type of chemotherapy or just continue the supportive care. No? Give pain medications, give proper nutrition, make sure that he has proper nutrition, mm-hmm, and the like.
In the latest NCCN, the National Cancer Comprehensive Network, the utility of the CA-199, the one that I mentioned a while ago, its utility has expanded to somehow predict the disease-free survival of patients who have received either surgery or chemotherapy. So on monitoring if this CA-199 would show a trend towards a decline or towards a tendency to be normalized, then most likely your outcome is better than those who do not develop any changes or a decline in their CA-19-9.
Mm-hmm. So with this new, is this a new development? Is this a new advancement?
This is the latest. This is the latest addition that I was able to encounter.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk about more latest advancements that you've encountered, that you've experienced, and we'll talk about a change in lifestyle for one who has pancreatic cancer, support of the family, and more on pancreatic cancer when MedTalk returns.
Did you know that recent studies suggest that quitting smoking, even for those who have smoked for most of his or her life, may reduce the risk of developing pancreatic cancer by up to 30%?
We're back here on MedTalk, still talking about pancreatic cancer. This time, doctors, let's talk about the side effects of the medication. When one goes for chemotherapy, one takes certain types of drugs to alleviate the pain, to improve one's quality of life. Are there side effects?
Cancer cells, in general, these are cells that divide quickly, and they are being targeted by the chemotherapy drugs. But at the same time, even if the cancer cells are the ones being targeted, other quickly dividing cells in the body can also be affected by the chemotherapy being given. Mm-hmm. So what are these other cells? So the cells lining the mucosa of from the mouth up to our intestine, this can be affected, our skin, the hair. So you can see that some of the common side effects of chemotherapy therapeutic drugs can be nausea and vomiting. But we have many treatments for this, or preventive treatments for nausea and vomiting. There can be some loss of hair depending on the chemo drug being given, but the hair will grow back after about 2 to 3 months being off the drug. There can be some weight loss or some loss of appetite, especially in the first few days after the chemo was given. Mm-hmm. Also fatigue during the first week. And most importantly, the chemotherapy drug can also affect the bone marrow cells. So the bone marrow produces the red blood cells, the white blood cells, and the platelets. So when the chemo comes in, all of these cells can be reduced in their production. So there can be increased risk for bleeding for the platelets. There can be anemia or fatigability because of the decrease in the red blood cells. And most importantly, there can be increased risk for infection because our white blood cells give us that immune defense. So these are the things that we really have to watch out for when the patient undergoes chemotherapy.
So these are the things that are to be expected by a patient when one is undergoing chemotherapy.
Yes. Although the degree or the severity of each one would actually differ per patient. Usually the dictum is the stronger the patient is, the less the side effects are felt. Mm-hmm. But of course, the weaker the patient is, then that's why we give them option of either just a single agent drug, or we do it. There's another type of regimen to be given if the patient is quite weak already.
Mm-hmm. So what does one do, given all the side effects of the treatment? How do you, like the vomiting or the other?
We advise patients, if there is decrease in appetite, they should still will themselves to eat, right? So if sometimes they feel full immediately, so we advise them to eat small frequent feedings, so every 2 hours, every 3 hours you eat, and then try to avoid, I think, lettuce or cabbage, certain vegetables that can make you feel full and bloated. So during the first few days or first week after the chemo, it's best that they stay away from this. Of course, let them have a healthy lifestyle. We encourage them actually to exercise at their own pace. If they can do walking, 20 minutes, 30
Just
minutes a day.
Light exercise lang.
I advise them, especially in the first treatment, or you cut down on your physical activity, maybe 50%, and then you can see for yourself actually how how strong you are or how weak you feel after. Mm-hmm. So it's up to them also when they can return back to work. Some of them can go back to work after maybe 3 or 4 days or 1 week after the chemo.
Mm-hmm. And then continuous chemotherapy until
Depending on the purpose of the chemo. So if it is just adjuvant, meaning it's just in addition to the surgery, because the surgery removed all the tumor and you just want to decrease the risk of the tumor coming back, then usually it's a fixed number of cycles, maybe 4-6 cycles, so around 5 to 6 months mm-hmm. after. But if it's in a palliative setting or advanced setting and you really want to relieve some of the symptoms of the patient, so it can be quite continuous.
Okay. And the patients feel better after several cycles? They're able to go back to the same quality of life they had prior to the medication and
some
the treatment?
Some of them, yes, some of them can.
Okay.
Yeah, like Steve Jobs, he was up and about.
Yes, he was up and about. Yeah. No? And we saw so many images of him looking. He was very thin already we really didn't know that he had pancreatic cancer until the last few.
I think he underwent surgery in the early years.
Mm-hmm. So years, you mentioned years. So nagtagal.
Nagtagal siya.
And because of the surgery.
Because of the surgery, and mm-hmm. then I think he received several treatments thereafter. Mm-hmm. Because in after surgery, after chemotherapy, there's what we call surveillance.
Okay.
So the treatment does not stop there. You still undergo several monitoring or surveillance even mm-hmm. after you receive all of these CT scan, then repeat blood examinations, imaging of the chest as well.
Mm-hmm. Even with all of these, I know earlier off cam we said we won't talk about survival rate, but I think it's important to mention the survival rate of those who are diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, who have received treatment, received medication. What are their chances of surviving long after the cancer has been treated? Dr. Cherry?
The U.S. data would put a survival rate after 5 years, no, for 5 years from the patient's diagnosis. Stage 1A, it's around 14%.
Okay.
So most probably, these patients have had surgery, no?
Mm-mm.
14%, and it goes slower. So it becomes 12%, 7%, 5%. So the stage 4, the 5-year survival rate is around 1%. So 100 persons, and you are the winner because you survive, you outlive them also, mm-hmm. around 1%. No? But again, these are statistics.
Okay.
So it doesn't really follow naman na that particular patient, no, will have that. So it's really a combination of other factors. So
yes.
The patient's overall general health, how strong is he to actually undergo the treatment anyway, no?
That's right. Mm.
Just to emphasize the benefit of undergoing chemotherapy instead of just waiting for this 4 to 6 months without doing anything.
Yes. Are there patients who wait 4 to 6 months without doing anything?
No, these are the patients who do not want to have anything more done on them.
Okay.
So with the advent of the gemcitabine, which is a chemotherapeutic agent, the 4 to 6 months was prolonged to 10 months.
Mm.
10 months,
mm-hmm.
and
by
then there are newer combinations that are being given now. That's why
it's
a while ago
higher,
I mentioned 36 months already.
Okay, mm-hmm. So others talaga opt not to get any treatment, not to get surgery.
Because of you know, naunahan kasi ng.
Naunahan ng takot.
Oh, you can't help that rin, eh, no? That's how you feel. That's how an individual feels given the circumstance, the medical condition that he or she is in. Briefly, let's go back to the diagnostics.
Yes.
Let's not end the show without mentioning the other diagnostics. You mentioned blood tests. What are the other
patients who are, because they are jaundiced, they are usually the initial imaging is the ultrasound. But the ultrasound is a poor imaging of the pancreas. That's why the best is still a CT scan using the pancreas protocol. These are thin slices using oral as well as IV contrast. Then we have the MRI. Nowadays, you also utilize the endoscopic ultrasound, where it's like an endoscope, but at the tip, there's an ultrasound there,
okay.
and it is imaged from inside. So the advantage of the endoscopic ultrasound is that you can take biopsies while inside, and it's able to assess also the nodal involvement, the extent of the lesion.
Mm-hmm.
And MRI, endoscopy? Biopsy, of course. No? Biopsy is essential in the diagnosis of pancreatic cancer, mm-hmm. because you would know if it's just if it's the adenocarcinoma or the other benign cystic diseases of the pancreas.
Mm-hmm. The biopsy, that means the doctor would take a sample, yes. of the tumor, and usually we usually require a biopsy, especially if they need treatment prior to surgery. So if the doctors, the team of doctors would plan, we need to give chemo first or radiation first before the surgery, we really need to have that biopsy. But if mm-hmm. if the surgeon or the doctor see that this really looks like pancreatic cancer and this is actually can be operated, so they don't need to do the biopsy up front. So they can just remove the tumor and then have it biopsied or examined later on, the entire specimen. Mm-hmm.
So there are different options, yes. in diagnosing and in treating mm-hmm. the type, yes. of cancer, whether it be stage 1 to stage 4, yes. of pancreatic cancer.
Yes.
Any other latest development in diagnosing?
The use of biologic therapy, I think Sherry...
Okay, so this is not when you
therapy.
Say yeah, biological or
that targets the cellular pathways.
Okay.
So these are not the usual cytotoxic or cell killing chemotherapy agents that we know of. So targeted therapy, like nowadays, in combination with the gemcitabine, we make use also of erlotinib. This targets EGFR, which is a protein that can signal the abnormal cell to continue growing and multiplying.
Okay.
So they have studies that shown that a combination of the chemo, the gemcitabine plus the erlotinib targeted therapy would actually improve the survival for some patients. Mm-hmm. No?
Okay, this is from stage 1 to stage 4?
Right now it's just for stage 4. Stage 4.
And
the side effects of targeted therapy, they're usually a little less in number and in severity compared to the chemo mm-hmm. drugs, and usual side effects can be rashes, no, like acne,
okay.
sometimes, no, acne, diarrhea,
redness of the palm,
and fatigue,
as the side effects as you mentioned earlier from chemotherapy,
yes.
and radiation.
Yes.
Doctors, final words or tips. How do we take care of our pancreas? How do we sure that it is healthy and functioning well? Doc,
well, if you are a smoker now, I think you should think about quitting. Then if you are a strong alcoholic drinker and you have recurrent bouts of pancreatitis, then you should really think hard about your lifestyle. Then, of course, a diet that is good, rich in fruits and vegetables, low in fat and low in meat, no? is good also for your pancreas. There's also study about the advantage of supplementing with vitamin D,
okay.
to prevent the occurrence of pancreatic cancer.
Mm-hmm. Going under the sun at a good hour, sun.
But if you have a family history, but if you have a strong family history, go for a checkup.
Okay.
Screening. Although there are no guidelines yet on how to really screen well patients for pancreatic cancer.
Mm-hmm. But those guidelines you've mentioned are very vital already,
yes.
in helping us protect,
yes.
our pancreas. Doc Cherry, final message to all our viewers.
So for pancreatic cancer, they just don't need to be aware of the history of cancer in their family. They also need to be aware if there's history of like breast cancer, colon, ovary, because some syndromes, no, can also make them at higher risk for pancreatic cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the pancreas is quite ano no, parang medyo hindi siya kilala natin.
Yes.
Pero since it's quite a deadly disease and it's hard to detect at an early stage, then we should be more aware of it. And if you feel that there is something not going right with your body, no, don't just dismiss it na ay indigestion lang yan, ay ulcer lang yan. If it has been going on for quite some time, you really need to have yourself checked.
Mm-hmm. So thank you very much, Doc, yes. Mitch and Doc Cherry, for bringing that awareness to all of us. We'll see you again next Tuesday, 7 p.m. here on MedTalk. We'd like to thank the one who sent our Facebook question. Thank you very much. Here on MedTalk, your scheduled on-air consultation on 9TV. This is Angel Jacob. Good night.